Xi Jinping, who is, I think, well, somewhat like his predecessor, Hu Jintao. I still remember very, very clearly that when Hu Jintao first became General Secretary and Commander-in-Chief, people in the West were asking who's who. Now it's the turn of Xi Jinping. Xi Jinping has, I think, elicited a lot of attention, not only because he's now seen as the potentially the second most powerful person in the world, but also because of his fairly unusual background and upbringing. He is a charismatic princeling, which for some people in China might seem to be a contradiction in terms, because most people's conception of princelings, reference to the sons and daughters of party elders, think that most princelings are arrogant. They are beneficiaries of being members of the red aristocracy, which has its particular privileges. Most of the princelings are multi-billionaires, and I think after the global financial crisis in the US, the princelings' investments in the US have played a big role in propping up the real estate market here. They are buying up apartments, condominiums, houses with cash in places like New York, Silicon Valley, and so forth. But Xi Jinping is different. Xi Jinping is different. I remember when I first I was covering China from the early 80s onwards, Deng Xiaoping, one of the major instructions of Deng Xiaoping, who was a victim of the Cultural Revolution and who was determined that the Mao Zedong style of ruling by diktat, ruling by a fairly harsh podium, was that having gone through the Cultural Revolution, princeling should no longer aspire to be senior officials in the party or government. So Deng Xiaoping actually advised his own children, okay, to go into business. The other avenue where princelings are encouraged to go are the PLA. The PLA, where I think, like most militaries in the world, it's good to have a father, uncle to be a senior official, so that the princelings in the PLA actually have a leg up the competition in terms of going up the hierarchy. Very few, relatively few princelings actually chose the profession of politics, and Xi Jinping was different. Xi Jinping was different. Before I go into Xi Jinping, I would like to briefly explain this very interesting picture. Well, after I read Martin Shark's book, China Will Be Ruling the World in the 21st Century, I was at pains to find some image to show one or two aspects where China is, but not doing that well, okay? Not doing that well. And soccer is one of this, okay? Soccer is one of the areas where China is not doing that well, even though we hear consistently rumors that some of these big tycoons, they are buying up Manchester United, they're buying up Real Madrid, they're buying up Barcelona and so forth. So it's interesting that soccer is not only Xi Jinping's passion, but one area where he decidedly wants to raise China's game. Okay, here we have the Chinese dream. Xi Jinping is not a very brainy person, okay? Well, even though, as has been demonstrated by many very effective presidents, including Ronald Reagan from California, you don't need to be a policy wonk to succeed immensely as a leader of a country. Xi Jinping is not a brainy person, even though I think he's highly intelligent, he's highly reactive to new developments in the country. He's not a brainy person. So the only major slogan or mantra which he has come up with is just the Chinese dream, okay, the Chinese dream. And the Chinese dream has a hugely nationalistic element, okay, hugely nationalistic element. Simply put, it simply means that by the year 2021, that means the centenary of the establishment of the Communist Party, China will have attained a level of moderate prosperity in Chinese Xiaohong Shehui. But the next watershed will be much more important, and that is by the year 2049, the centenary of the establishment of the PRC, China will have largely closed the gap in terms of economic might and military capacity with the US. Okay, so I think many of you might have read the bestseller by one of my good friends in Washington, Michael Pillsbury, the 100-year marathon, in which Pillsbury wrote that Beijing had this not-so-secret agenda to overtake the U.S. and then displace the U.S. as the world's sole superpower within 100 years. But in actual fact, Xi Jinping is a lot more ambitious than that. I think he has put in place, into place, measures and very ambitious policies, investments in the military and so forth, to enable China at the middle of the coming of the current century to marginalize the US, at least within the Asia Pacific region, so that Beijing would become, in effect, the final arbiter of geopolitical, economic, trading activities in the Asia Pacific region. So Xi Jinping is a hugely ambitious person, and from this point of view, we can see that he is much different from his immediate predecessor, Hu Jintao, whom I think most of us are well informed about, because Hu Jintao has visited the US several times. But Hu Jintao has never impressed either Chinese or Western audience as a person with a clear-cut mission. The problem with Hu Jintao is that all his life he was a successful bureaucrat, a successful apparatchik, a successful mishu or secretary. So he had climbed up the hierarchy step by step through partly currying favor with his mentors and so forth. So Hu Jintao was not known to have excessively ambitious ambitions and so forth, but not Xi Jinping, okay? But not Xi Jinping. And here, the a portrait of the supreme leader as a young man, we knew from this picture, which was taken when Xi Jinping was in his 20s, that he decided from very early on to climb to the very top, to climb to the very top. He mentioned in an interview with the Chinese media that, well, this was 1982. He had, after graduation from this elite Tsinghua University in 1979, spent 3 years working on a plum job as a secretary in the Central Military Commission's General Office, which is the nerve center of the entire PLA. But of course, he got a plum job right after graduation from Tsinghua through his father, because his much revered father, former Vice Premier Xi Zhongxun, was a good friend of the then Defense Minister Gong Biao. So the first 3 years of his life in the military, he performed the role of one of the confidential secretaries of Gong Biao. Gong Biao actually made the visit to the U.S. in 1980, but even though Xi Jinping, of course, was not senior enough to accompany Defense Minister Gong, I think we can conclude that from his early days, he was aware of the intricate relationship between China and the U.S. the Gang Biao trip happened to be very successful because Mr. Gang persuaded the Carter White House to actually sell non-lethal weapons to China, things like helicopters, transport airplanes, and so forth. And I think most of us should remember that after the June 4th crisis, this American-led embargo of the sale of weapons to China still stands, okay, still stands after 35 years. But more importantly, about Xi Jinping in this watershed point of his life was that he decided to build his career from the grassroots, okay? So at that time, he told the interviewers that amongst the high-born princelings, the people with so-called revolutionary bloodline, there were only two people, he and Liu Yuan. Liu Yuan happened to be the son of China's first president, state president, Liu Shaoqi. So he said only two people decided to leave Beijing, which at that time was already had a lot of creature comforts because the open door policy under Deng Xiaoping had already begun. So, but they decided to go against the grain by spending their time as party secretaries, working from the bottom up. Xi Jinping became first the vice party secretary and then the party secretary of Yongding province in Hebei province. And it was during that stint in Yongding that he made a trip to Iowa, okay? He spent, I think, 2-3 weeks with a ordinary farm family in Iowa. And you might remember that when he made his first trip as president, Chinese president to the US, he made a stopover in Iowa, and he was able to identify his host at the time. So it was very interesting that Xi Jinping began his career with a firm goal in mind. That means to at least get into the Politburo Standing Committee, which is China's highest governing council. But the other aspect of Xi Jinping is that, well, this is the other side of the coin. For those of us with some understanding of Chinese politics, we realize that for a mid-ranking rising star, somebody who is anxious to go up the hierarchy, that is the worst sin, the worst taboo is to be seen as overly ambitious. The worst sin is to be seen as trying to upstage your supervisors and not being obedient enough to your supervisors, to the party elders, and so forth. So Xi Jinping has developed this ability to hide his ambitions. Throughout his career, he spent 15 years in Fujian province along the coast just opposite Taiwan, and then 5 years in prosperous Zhejiang province, again, coastal province. But he came across as a fairly mediocre administrator. He also came across as a regional cadre who always manages to take good care of the party elders, because there's a long tradition that in the harsh winter of Beijing, the party elders would always repair to the south to enjoy a more hospitable climate. Above all, he was seen as a consensus-driven politician, as a team player. And so that's why in 2007, at the last party congress, Xi Jinping, as you might remember, came to power at the 18th party congress in 2012. So 5 years earlier, at the 17th party congress, he was chosen by Jiang Zemin to be the successor of Hu Jintao. So we already see here a display of somewhat Machiavellian ability to maneuver his way up the Chinese hierarchy. but more on the Chinese dream, more on the Chinese dream. Well, this is, of course, only an artist's impression, but the artist, I think, was right on target. Many people now, many of my friends in China now call him Emperor Xi, okay? Emperor Xi, and I'll explain in more detail. But more regarding his, major ambitions, his goals for the country, his approach to governance, his well-willed and his statecraft. The first question I think we need to answer about Xi Jinping is this question of neo-authoritarianism. Neo-authoritarianism, to put it simply, was first put forward by Deng Xiaoping, who was the chief architect of reform. Okay, and Deng Xiaoping, when he put forward this theory of neo-authoritarianism, was heavily influenced by Lee Kuan Yew. Okay, Lee Kuan Yew, who just unfortunately passed away a few months ago. So, the theory of neo-authoritarianism is actually very simple. It just says that in a developing country, particularly a country as complex as China, the ruler who is determined to push through reform, he has to have near absolutist powers. And Xi Jinping has reiterated that reform, having reached its 35th, 36th year, the easier jobs are all done. The easier jobs meaning reform, whether it's economic, political, which do not impinge upon the Western interests of power blocks, which would not invite resistance because of the damage to the Western interests of the red aristocracy and so forth. So Xi Jinping said, those easy reforms have all been done. We have now entered the so-called deep water zone of reform, the more difficult reforms, okay? So his justification for, which I'll explain later, for unprecedented consolidation of power is that he needs that power to push through reforms, okay? So the big question now is, he has been in power for 2.5 years. It looks like he will serve the usual two terms of 5 years each. That means until the 20th Party Congress in 2022, even though, as I will explain later, my theory is that he has already made up his mind to emulate his good friend, President Vladimir Putin, who just a few months ago celebrated his 15 years in power. So Xi Jinping, according to my reading, of course you could challenge me in the Q&A period, is that he has already determined to rule until at least the year 2027, okay, 2027, when he will be only 74 years old. And here I must state one of the first state secrets which I will divulge within this speech. I'm 1 year older than Xi Jinping, okay? So we all belong to this early middle age period in our lives, okay? We just cross over from being youngsters into early middle agehood. So well, people in our generation are still very energetic, okay? So I fully empathize with President Xi's ambition to stay around for at least 12 and a half more years, okay? And by 2027 at the 21st Party Congress, Xi Jinping, as I said, will only be 74. And in a country which respects old age, 74 is, a 74-year-old man is, well, not exactly a spring chicken, but he will be, he will have entered the middle part of middle agehood, okay? So I can assure you that he will have enough energy, okay, to run the country. So the big question now, of course, is, as I'll explain later, whether he will indeed push those difficult reforms. But before we answer this question, it is, I think, very useful for us to tackle what I call the secret, or actually not so secret, personal agendas of Xi Jinping. According to the Chinese stream, okay, according to the Chinese stream, which actually is not that new, okay, and I already said at the beginning that Xi Jinping is not known for his originality, okay. The Chinese stream was first conjured up by China's first generation of reformers in 1898. There was something called the 100 Days Reform, which failed desperately, which failed because of opposition from the Empress Dowager, because the young emperor who was pushing the reform, Wang Xu, did not have authority. And what happened was the power behind the throne, the Qi Xi Taihou, the Empress Dowager, Qi Xi, actually stopped the reforms after a mere 100 days. But the content and of the reforms have remained the same. That means a strong country, a prosperous country, okay? Fu Guo Changbing, a prosperous country and a strong military. But I would argue that Xi Jinping has added new elements to this, okay? New elements to this. So the first one is that Fu Guo Changbing, you know, this slogan of a prosperous country and a strong military, must be predicated upon an ever more powerful party. So in fact, the further extension of the powers of the party is a prerequisite for China's realizing the age-old dream of a prosperous country and a strong military. And I would like to draw your attention particularly to this very important speech, which seems to have been overlooked by a number of analysts. And this is a speech which Xi Jinping gave several years ago when he was still vice president. So he said, and I quote, whatever powers we possessed in the past, we may not possess them now, okay? Whatever powers we possess now, irrespective of how the party today is so powerful, this doesn't mean that we can possess them forever, okay? So this is his theoretical argument for ensuring that the Communist Party remains China's perennial ruling party, okay? Well, you can say that he might have borrowed from the playbook of Lee Kuan Yew, because the People's Action Party seems to have succeeded to become Singapore's perennial ruling party. However, the Chinese context is different. Okay, for time limitations, I will not do a textual analysis of this remarkable saying, except to say that this is totally non-Marxist, okay? And this aspiration to turn the Communist Party into a perennial ruling party makes it very clear that Xi Jinping is not a Marxist, okay? Because, well, at least according to my very limited knowledge of Marxism, picked up by one course, Marxism 101, taken about 40 years ago. Karl Marx is not only a distinguished economist, political scientist, and he's also a remarkable historian, okay? And some of the most famous sayings from Karl Marx refers to the law of the progress of history, okay? So for Marx, the key word for Marxism is change, okay? It's change. So society, civilizations, dynasties, political parties, they go through dramatic changes given the changes in the substructure, okay? Substructure, of course, referring to economic improvement, changes in productivity, changes in technology, and so forth. So for a person who claims to be the head of the world's largest socialist party, to aspire to be the ruler of a party which never changes, okay? Because the concept of a perennial ruling party precisely means that no changes are allowed, okay? No changes are allowed. And in the second And last half of my presentation, I will point out the draconian, very tough, very severe measures which Xi Jinping has put into place to stop, to put an end, to annihilate the challenges, big and small, to the party, coming from dissidents, human rights lawyers, NGO activists, and so forth. So this is something we need to bear in mind as we continue to examine the evolution of Xi Jinping's worldview and his statecraft. The corollary, okay, the corollary of a party which doesn't change, a party which remains China's perennial ruling party, is that the leader of such a party, okay, the leader of such a party will also retain his near supreme powers, okay? And I just mentioned the fact that originally, according to conventions within the party, a general secretary should only serve for 2 terms, that means 10 years, but he's now determined to extend that to at least 15 years. So, okay, before that, also, I need to point out that his Xi Jinping's inspiration for mentioning the goal of a perennial ruling party is massive influence from the collapse of the Soviet party unexpectedly and totally in 1991. So, the first major speech given by Xi Jinping, 1 month after he became number one in the party, was a speech in which he counseled his associates, underlings, and other party members never to follow the example of the Soviet party. And according to Xi Jinping, the Soviet party collapsed because it lost the control of the gun and the knife. Okay, the gun refers to the army, the knife refers to the police, including the KGB, of course. The second takeaway by Xi Jinping from the Soviet experience was that the party collapsed because it has lost control of the economy. Okay, economy. So we can discuss this later on because one of the major challenges of the Chinese economic system, one of the major economic reforms, involves the reform and restructuring of the state-owned enterprise conglomerates. So Xi Jinping, who is insistent upon the party's control of the economy, has decided not to liberalize the huge state-owned enterprises, the what some economists call the Chinese equivalent to the South Korean chaebol, okay, these huge companies in South Korea. And then the third point, which is also very important. Xi Jinping said the Soviet party collapsed because younger leaders such as Gorbachev and Yeltsin have abandoned the teachings of Lenin and Stalin. Okay, so like his mentor, Mao Zedong, Xi Jinping was adamantly opposed to de-Stalinization. Okay? I think those of us who have studied China-Soviet relations should know that after Khrushchev's now famous de-Stalinization speech, Mao Zedong decided to break with the Soviet Union. So Xi Jinping agrees with Mao Zedong, saying that once the authority of the founders of any political party had lost his authority, then the party might lose its moral legitimacy and might collapse. So that's why you will see that in his brief tenure of 2.5 years, Xi Jinping has gone about resuscitating many of the norms, the values of Mao Zedong. Okay. And then the third point, which I already raised, and that is the corollary of a Communist Party being a perennial ruling party, is that the party chief, okay, the party chief must also have a monopoly of the political powers, political resources of the country, and that's why he decided to stay beyond the usual 10 years. Okay, so amongst the major Maoist institutions, norms, values Xi Jinping has reinvigorated is the personality cult, okay? Personality cult. So we have the what the Chinese call the new helmsman, okay? Mao Zedong's nickname was the Great Helmsman. So this is the new helmsman. Okay, and then some of the other familiar paraphernalia of hero worship. Okay, so here we see Xi Jinping as the worthy standard bearer of Mao Zedong values. Okay, and here we have the Xi Jinping is the first leader to have a big team of young PR professionals, and he has benefited from the propaganda making potentials of the new media. And even though Google, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and so forth are banned in China, the Chinese leadership has allowed equivalence. And here we see coming into the market 2 months ago, a Xi Jinping app, okay? This is a Xi Jinping app, which keeps his millions of fans up to date about his activities, his latest instructions, and so forth. But our irreverent Western correspondents in Beijing have termed the app an electronic little red book for the 21st century. Okay, so whether this is appropriate, you can draw your own conclusion. But the important thing is that in order to consolidate his leadership and his powers, I would submit, and this is one of the major arguments of the book, that Xi Jinping is a fervent disciple of Mao Zedong, regarding Deng Xiaoping, he has actually repudiated. He has thrown out of the window many of the major teachings of Deng Xiaoping, the first one of which is the country should be run as a leadership collective, okay? The Politburo Standing Committee should run the country as a leadership collective. So there would be no more dictator like Mao Zedong. The General Secretary, okay, the top official, should at most be the first amongst equals, and should they come across controversial decisions, for example, whether the PLA should be called upon to clear out Tiananmen Square, then the Standing Committee should cast votes to determine, and the vote of the General Secretary bears the same weight as those of his colleagues in the Standing Committee. Okay, the second one, of course, is no personality cult. Okay, and the third one, no more Cultural Revolution style ideological campaigns. Whereas almost from day one, Xi Jinping has staged several such ideological campaigns. And perhaps even more importantly, Deng Xiaoping preached this very important principle of separation of party and government, meaning that the Communist Party hierarchy and the top organs of the party should only concern themselves with long-range goals, the major directions for the country, major ideological orientations, and so forth. Whereas the actual ruling of the country, okay, the day-to-day administration of the country should be left to professional administrators and technocrats within the state council or the central government. However, we have seen that in order to consolidate and perpetuate his power, Xi Jinping has done exactly the opposite. He has created new and super powerful organs at the apex of the party, which has arrogated to themselves full decision-making powers on things like not just the military foreign policy, but also the economy. So he has created, just in the past 2 years, new bodies at the apex of the party, including the Central National Security Commission, which is, as some harsh critics say, the Chinese equivalent of the KGB. He has also created another humongous high-level decision-making organ within the party called the Central Leading Group on Comprehensively Deepening Reform, and Xi Jinping is the chairman of all this. Okay, the third high-level committee he created was the Central Leading Group on Internet Security and IT Development. So meaning that Xi Jinping himself, again, is personally responsible for internet security and also the development of e-commerce, social media, and so forth. And just one brief aside, and that is Xi Jinping is super paranoid about the possibility that the new media might impinge upon the party's monopoly on the country's political resources. Because obviously, the appearance of the internet, the fact that there are now 700 million Chinese who are called netizens, who spend at least 2-3 hours on the net as well as on social media, well, this has deprived the party of its monopoly on information. Okay, and Xi Jinping once said internally that whether the party, whether we can control the internet is a matter of life and death for the party. Okay, I'm running out of time, so I will just focus on, I won't have time to discuss some of Xi Jinping's leadership style, but I must point out this very interesting picture of Xi Jinping. This was in 2013, inspecting the central city of Wuhan. It was raining heavily, and Xi Jinping, despite his revolutionary bloodline, he has come across as a man of the people, a close comrade of workers. So he not only carries his own umbrella, but he actually rolled up the bottom of his trousers, and this has come to be known as a down-to-earth pants rolled up work style. Okay, which befits the 21st century charismatic princeling. Okay, so I will, in the last part of my presentation, focus on two major objectives or accomplishments of Xi Jinping. Well, the first one, which has been reported and discussed widely in the Western media, is his anti-corruption campaign, okay, his anti-corruption campaign. Despite my reputation as a critic of Xi Jinping, I think I would give him high credit for having masterminded perhaps the most far-reaching, effective and efficient anti-corruption campaign in the party's history. Okay, so if you look at the numbers of venal officials, corrupt officials with the rank of ministers or above, then you can see clearly that the number of senior officials who have been incriminated, prosecuted, and so forth are more than such officials arrested by Hu Jintao and Jiang Zemin, his two predecessors, put together. Okay, so there's no question that he is an effective graft buster. However, from the other perspective, particularly if you look at the big tigers, okay, Xi Jinping was famous for this earthly saying that we have to hit out at the big tigers as well as the small flies. Okay, so if you look at the big tigers, you will see that the big tigers which he has netted are, without an exception, his political enemies. Okay, so this has given rise to the question of whether Xi Jinping has, in fact, merely followed what Mao Zedong did, beginning from the 1930s in the caves of Yan'an, you know, this early revolutionary base. Because from the 1930s onwards, Mao Zedong began the long tradition of annihilating, removing his political foes using the anti-corruption card as a potent weapon. Okay, and more recently, we have examples of his two predecessors, Jiang Zemin, using exactly the same anti-corruption tactic to remove the then Beijing Party Secretary Chen Xitong, who was his bitter political foe. And similarly, Hu Jintao, despite his appearance as a timid official, Hu Jintao used the same trick to devastate his political enemy, the Shanghai Party Secretary Chen Liangyu. Okay, but the even more serious problem with Xi Jinping's anti-corruption campaign is that, despite his rhetorical support for the what I would call the rule by law with Chinese characteristics, okay, because in China there is no rule of law, okay, there's only rule by law. That means the country is being run by law under the tight supervision of the party. So despite his rhetorical support for obeying the constitution, obeying the law, the anti-corruption campaign has been waged actually not according to the standards of either rule by law or rule of law, because the anti-corruption campaign has been masterminded, organized, and perpetuated by a very shadowy organ at the top of the party called the Central Commission for Disciplinary Inspection, okay, CCDI. Well, the CCDI is a totally non-transparent and secretive organ, which is not subject to the scrutiny of either the legislature or the judiciary, okay? So the CCDI has the power to arrest officials without court warrant, without a permit from the court. And according to my friends in Beijing, the decision as to who to target, particularly which big tiger to go after, is made only by two people. One is Wang Qishan, the head of the CCDI, who is largely regarded as the second most powerful person in the country, just after Xi Jinping and, of course, Xi Jinping himself. And in the Q&A period, if you're interested, I can give you more examples of how the CCDI has taken advantage of its special powers and privileges to build a big empire. Okay, so Wang Qishan, in fact, is now running one of the biggest establishments at the apex of the party, the anti-corruption operation, which is one of the most powerful organs within the party and totally without supervision or scrutiny. Well, lastly, I turn to the rule of law, okay? The rule of law with Chinese characteristics. I think, again, Xi Jinping deserves a lot of credit for giving a prominent place to rule by law with Chinese characteristics. So at this, he convened, if I remember correctly, Xi Jinping was the only general secretary who convened a special Central Committee meeting. As some of us know, the Central Committee of the CCP, of the party, which is a policy-setting organ. They only meet at least once or twice a year, okay? They only meet twice or sometimes just once a year. So Xi Jinping devoted an entire Central Committee meeting to this topic of rule of law. And he said this, he has reiterated that in China, no organization or individuals has the special privilege of overriding the constitution and the law. Okay, he also added that the judicial system is the last defense for social justice. And if the judicial system were to fail, people will widely question Beijing's commitment to social justice and so forth. However, we must pay more attention to the caveat, which is the party's leadership and its supreme authority is the most essential feature of socialism with Chinese characteristics and the most fundamental guarantee of socialist rule of law. So in other words, rule of law under tight party supervision. And here, I must make my perhaps my last digression, my last aside. And this, I think that apart from Mao Zedong, Xi Jinping is a faithful follower of this famous strategist Han Fei. Okay, well, Han Fei is not very well known in China because he lived in the 2nd, 3rd century BC, but he was a contemporary of Confucius. I have read most of his books. He's a brilliant thinker, and his specialty is to enable emperors to consolidate their power through using strict laws and harsh punishments, okay? Helping emperors consolidate their power through using strict laws and harsh punishment. And this is Xi Jinping's takeaway from Han Fei, okay? Who is, according to myself, one of the most brilliant thinkers in old China. So, and Xi Jinping, he is conscious of the powers of the law, and he's the first communist leader. He's much better than Jiang Zemin or Deng Xiaoping or Hu Jintao in putting together a comprehensive system of laws to guard against threats to national security. So, first of all, as I mentioned, he set up this what some critics call the Chinese equivalent of the KGB, okay, the Central National Security Commission, the in Chinese the 中央国家安全委员会, and when he started running the council, he mentioned that from now on, and this is one major invention of Xi Jinping, and that is we must take, and I quote, we must take a holistic, comprehensive approach to national security. So Xi Jinping listed 11 areas of national security, threats to national security, some coming from within China, for example, the dissidents, people like the Nobel Peace Prize laureate Liu Xiaobo, who is still behind bars, but also threats to security coming from abroad. So for example, alleged support which certain Muslim states have given to the Uyghurs in Xinjiang, and of course the big bugbear, the US, giving support to the Dalai Lama's exiled government. So Xi Jinping was the first leader to propose a holistic look, okay, in defending national security, taking care of both their domestic and the foreign components. And what is even more, what is even more interesting is that he has put together a comprehensive legal framework to uphold national security. And so we have seen that within 2 years, he has put together the draft on a very important law on national security, okay? Law on national security, which handles not just secession, sedition, but also leakage of state secret. And this law will be passed in March 2013. So when I was giving this presentation in Hong Kong, I always told my audience that, well, after the law is passed in March 2016, this will have a rollover impact on Hong Kong. So I was telling my audience that, well, we still have a window of 9 months, okay, to to discuss national secrets, to critique Xi Jinping and so forth. Well, the window lasting about 9 months, okay, until the law is passed in March by the rubber stamp National People's Congress. And secondly, the law on state secrets, the law against spying, the anti-terrorism law, regulations again, regulations on foreign NGOs. And here, a brief aside, a brief digression. The Xi Jinping is extremely hostile to foreign NGOs, particularly, and also Chinese NGOs, which have received funding support from foundations, particularly foundations in the US, okay? And also, regulations against rumor mongering on the internet. Okay, so I will just fast forward some of the PowerPoints, some of the slides which I've also prepared. But of course, it will take about 5 more hours for me to run through the slides. So that's why I would recommend you to buy the book, okay? To buy the book, which is the real thing, which is the real thing, okay? So just very briefly, okay, very briefly, the I need to mention just one minute on his foreign policy agenda, because within the Chinese mantra, the Chinese dream mantra, there is this element of a strong military, okay, a strong military. And I will submit that China under Xi Jinping has been relentlessly projecting both hard and soft power, okay? And the gist of Xi Jinping's tactic actually is nothing new. As I said, Xi Jinping is not regarded as an original thinker. So it consists of a judicious mixture of the carrot and the stick, even though in China we see the stick much more often than the carrot, okay? So the stick consists of naked power, okay, naked power. The well, another state secret, the Chinese are building 2 to 3 state-of-the-art aircraft carriers. We already see many satellite images of huge structures being put together in the Shanghai and the Shenyang, the two major naval shipbuilding yards in China. So those are the future aircraft carriers. So the stake also consisting of the this is what John Kerry, the Secretary of State, went to Beijing a few days ago to talk about, and that is China's reclamations of the 6 or 7 islets, small rocks in the South China Sea, and they are building in one island, Woody Island, a 3,000 meter runway, okay, which could accommodate most Chinese jet fighters. They're also building naval facilities, which one day could surface Chinese submarines, okay? So this is a stake. Well, the carrot is economic inducements, okay? Economic inducements. So this is the now famous AIB, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. Okay, and so far, 57 countries, including some of America's closest allies, the UK, Germany, France, Australia, South Korea, have joined. And this is my last slide here, the One Belt, One Road strategy. This is China financing very ambitious infrastructure projects in a range of countries. So this is the road, this is the New Silk Road, okay, linking Xinjiang, okay, Xinjiang, which is a problematic area with the Uyghurs, linking Xinjiang with Central Asia, the Caucasus, all the way to Rotterdam, okay? Rotterdam, as some of our historians know, was the port of origin of the Old Silk Road, okay? Old merchants starting from Rotterdam going all the way to China. And then, even more importantly, the Maritime Silk Road, okay? The Maritime Silk Road, which is an extension of port facilities all the way from Fujian, where Xi Jinping ruled for 15 years, all the way from Fujian to Indonesia, Malaysia, all the way to Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Pakistan, and then ending in East Africa. And here I must mention fresh off the news item, and that is China has signed an MOU with Thailand, with Thailand, okay, with Thailand to build a Kra canal. So this has immense implications, okay, because for decades, not only China but Japan and some other countries, which are dependent on Middle Eastern oil. So these oil tankers, okay. All tankers bound for China and Japan, they have to go through the Strait of Malacca, which the Chinese are very paranoid about, because they fear that when if hostilities were to begin with the U.S., the U.S. would first blockade the Strait of Malacca. But now, the Kra Canal, even though I think it would take 20 years to build, would provide an alternative. But at the same time, the Chinese leadership already built a huge naval a port facility on the western coast of Myanmar, a deep water port called Sitri. Okay, and they have also built from Sitri a strong pipeline, okay, oil pipeline to carry the oil and gas offloaded from oil tankers here all the way to Kunming, which is the capital of Yunnan province, which is the province closest to the ASEAN countries. Okay, so I will just leave you with one of my favorite images of Xi Jinping, the commander-in-chief, the naval commander. And I'm sorry I've taken much more than my usual time, and I will welcome some free-flowing discussion. So I'm glad that the Chinese national security law doesn't extend across the Pacific, okay? So we can have some free-flowing discussion.